It is a fact of war that where possible, equipment and supplies will be captured and almost certainly be reused against their original owner. This was the case on the Eastern Front during the Second World War. Many Soviet and German tanks found their way into opposing armies. Both sides would experiment with replacing the main guns of captured vehicles with domestic models, meaning they wouldn't need to rely upon captured stockpiles of ammunition. Today, we're going to look at one such example that never made it off the drawing board. The T-5-85, a Panther mounting a Soviet 85mm gun. As a trophy tank, the Panther, known as the T-5 in Soviet service, was less well regarded compared to supposedly inferior brethren like the Panzer IV. A notoriously maintenance-intensive and sensitive vehicle, a captured Panther was often able to drive between 15 to 20 kilometers before mechanical issues necessitated its abandonment. These issues were compounded by a lack of spare parts for the vehicles and a lack of training on the part of the soldiers. The common Soviet soldier would not have the experience to operate and maintain a foreign vehicle as complex as the Panther. 40th Army Headquarters would expand on these issues, mentioning that they needed a continuous supply of high-quality aviation gasoline, and that ammunition was much harder to acquire because ammo for the more plentiful KWK-40 cannon was unsuitable for use with the Panther's KWK-42. Nevertheless, the Panther's excellent 75mm gun and optics meant the tank could engage vehicles at longer effective ranges than the Soviet 76 and 85mm guns. And the excellent radio suite of the Panther made it an attractive command vehicle. For instance, the 991st Self-Propelled Artillery Regiment operated a trio of Panthers as command vehicles for its Su-76Ms, although the much heavier Panther sometimes struggled in areas the lighter Su-76 could operate in with ease. Defense spending is a seriously pricey endeavor, and while tanks are by no means cheap, they don't even make up the bulk of a military's arsenal. In the last year, defense spending is one of the only economic sectors showing significant growth in the stock market, largely buoyed by the military help to Ukraine, which in more than 9 months has received over $30 billion from the US alone in military aid. In the meantime, the S&P is nearing a 20% decline this year to date, inflation is at a high level, and the real estate market is looking shaky. Experts are forecasting further declines next year, and with this in mind, investors are seeking shelter in other assets. And there's a physical asset that 85% of surveyed wealth managers think could be part of a wealth management offering, partly because it isn't necessarily subject to the volatility of the traditional markets. This is fine art. Over the last 26 years, contemporary art prices have outpaced the S&P 500 by 131%. For most people, there's just one issue. Until recently, just like buying a tank, it'd take you an arm and a leg to invest in fine art. After all, who has $10 million lying around to hang an authentic painting in their turret bustle, living room? Thanks to today's sponsor, Masterworks, almost anyone could avoid high volatility and find consistent performance in a new, exciting market. And these aren't NFTs or other modern mumbo-jumbo, this is work from legendary artists like Picasso, Banksy, and Monet. With their platform, you can invest in fractional shares in these paintings, and then either trade these shares or receive a profit when the painting is sold. Nearly 600,000 people have signed up so far, and demand has grown so much, they're looking to launch new SEC-qualified offerings on a weekly basis. But our subscribers can get priority access at the link in the description. However, before we go back to the Soviet Panther, a word of caution. Investing, while rewarding, is also risky, and just like in the military, information and knowledge are key. Thus, while we happily encourage you to check out our sponsor, we would also like to encourage you to read as much as possible about investments and art and make informed decisions. See important Reg A disclosures, masterworks.com/CD. The desire to mount a domestically produced main gun in the Panther came about in late 1944, with Tactical and Technical Requirement Number 2820. For the installation of domestic weapons in the turrets of captured German tanks, T-4, T-5, T-6, and the Royal Tiger, being published on the 28th of November of that year. This document would lay out the need for replacing the main gun and gun sight of captured tanks with domestic equipment. Consideration was also given to converted turrets as static emplacements, perhaps going a ways to suggest why the Soviets, despite looking to add a domestic weapon system, did not go further and replace more unreliable components with domestic equivalents that their soldiers would be familiar with. Work on these modifications would bear fruit a few months later, in January 1945, when State Union Special Design Bureau No. 43 presented a project for the installation of the 100mm D-10T, the same gun that would be used on the T-54 and the T-17 sight in the turret of a Tiger I. This would be known as the T-6-100. At the same time, similar projects with the Panzer IV and Panther also appeared, replacing their 75mm guns with a 76.2mm and 85mm gun, respectively. Interestingly, the Panther's conversion was estimated to take the longest in terms of machine hours. The Panzer IV and Tiger conversions could be completed in 80 and 90 machine hours, respectively. The Panther would have taken 120 hours to finish. Exactly which 85mm gun was to be installed on the Panther has never been made clear, although when taking in the requirements of the project, the gun had to have similar characteristics and not impact mobility, as well as needing to be an existing design. It becomes clear that there are two likely candidates, the D-5T and the ZIS-S-53. The D-5T was the older of the two, having been offered in May 1943 as a reworked version of the earlier U-12. Due to the inclusion of a semi-automatic breech block and recoil system assemblies, the design was distinctive enough to receive the D-5T index designation. Due to a short recoil and the compactness of the design, the D-5T could also be fitted to existing Soviet heavy tanks without altering the turrets. The gun was trial-fitted to both the KV-1S and IS and proved superior to the other 85mm guns on offer, namely the S-18 and S-31. The D-5T was adopted by the Red Army and would be fitted to both the KV-85 and IS-85 heavy tanks, as well as early models of the T-34-85 medium tank. Unfortunately, the design of the D-5T proved to be its undoing. The gun's peculiarities, as well as having many small details and parts requiring precise machining, meant it proved difficult to manufacture in large numbers. Only a single factory produced the gun. Two others involved in production could not actually build it, as they were unprepared to produce such a complex system. As the gun could not be built in large enough numbers to satisfy anticipated demand, production ceased on the 1st of March 1944. The decision to drop the D-5T was also due to the emergence of a newer 85mm gun. The S-53 had been quickly designed in December 1943 in response to an order to create a new 85mm gun for the T-34. Featuring a simplified design, the S-53 was much easier to build and cheaper to produce than the D-5T, and mass production began in February 1944. By the time the T-5-85 project had begun, the S-53 had been in production for nearly a year and was the mainstay weapon of the 1944 model of the T-34-85. By virtue of the number produced, as well as the common tanker's familiarity with the weapon, the S-53 seems the more likely weapon to have been installed on a captured Panther. Along with the gun, the Panther's gun sight and coaxial machine gun would have also been replaced by Soviet equivalents, namely the T-17 and the DT machine gun, respectively. No provision appears to have been made to replace the hull-mounted MG-34, again likely due to the view that the turrets would be used as standalone fortifications. Although if the tank in question wasn't going to be used in this way, the replacement of both machine guns, rather than just one, would seem the most likely and prudent of choices. The project, while technically feasible, never went beyond technical documentation. With the war in Europe close to its end, there was no pressing need for such converted tanks or fortifications. There is some speculation that the project could have been used in the post-war era to help equip the armies of devastated European countries who now found themselves under the Soviet sphere of influence, with the prospect of another war in Europe growing as relations between the USSR and the Western Allies deteriorated. The T-5-85 could have been issued to the armies of the Soviet Union's satellite states in the event of a war. It is unlikely such a project would have had a large impact, however. The Panthers would have been issued from captured stock in relatively small numbers, with an even smaller stockpile of spare parts available. As it was, the Panther saw little in the way of foreign use, the French and Romanians being perhaps the only notable post-war users, and most of the armies of the Warsaw Pact would instead be armed with Soviet domestic designs, primarily the T-34-85 and the later T-55 in the immediate post-war years and decades. And that's as far as the T-585 story went. What do you think? Should the Soviets have gone further in their design? Is there anything in the Panther you would have replaced? Have your say in the comments. If you enjoyed this video, remember to subscribe so you don't miss future releases. We also have a Patreon if you want to pitch in and help us make bigger and better videos. Until next time, keep us in your sights.